Singh, who holds a PhD degree with specialization in neuropsychology. Her work experience includes working in a military hospital, government medical college, and faculty member at premier universities in India and South Africa. She has made presentations for her exceptional work experience to Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, the previous President of India, Dr. C. Rangarajan, Dr. Karan Singh, Sri Surjit Singh Barnala, and many other dignitaries in different organizations where she has worked. At present, she is a consultant neuropsychologist at Apollo Hospitals in Hyderabad, Telangana, India. Her areas of interest include neuropsychological rehabilitation in traumatic brain surgery and stroke, behavioral and cognitive management of children with mental handicaps, counseling of substance addiction, post-traumatic stress disorder, psychological intervention and management of HIV seropositive cases and stress management processes. So I welcome Dr. Namita Singh, and I am handing over this session to you. Thank you very much.
Good morning, everybody. It's great to be here, and I would be sharing the slides with you to talk about mental health and stress management issues. It's a great privilege and honor to be presenting and talking to you, and I don't want any one of you to sleep off in the session, so we will keep it very interactive. Some information I just want to initially share with you, and then we can have queries, discussions, because human life and our day-to-day routines are similar in different aspects of socio-cultural systems where we live and what we work into. But emotions, feelings, desires, needs, all across the globe are same. So if anybody wants to take a break, I don't mind that. I would just request that as you people have been very persistently listening, learning, and giving your input through the last week, please hang on for this session also. So I'm sharing my...
Yes.
Please let me know if it is visible. Can you see the slides?
Yes, ma'am, it's visible.
Okay, great. So some of this information will look very minimal kind of numbers and details, but the point what here we are trying to make is that this is some little info regarding the numbers which were found in the National Mental Health Survey, which was done on mental illness in 2016 by NIMHANS, the premier institute in Bangalore, which is an authority on the different issues related to neuropsychological and mental health. So as you can see, male age group of 30 to 49 years most affected by mental disorders contributed to greater morbidity in the productive population. Prevalence of mental illness in male is much higher compared to female. Substance abuse, most of us know, related to disorder level, which is alcohol, tobacco, and other psychotropic elements, it's much higher in the male population. And more than this, the issue is that the prevalence of mental illness is much higher in our metro and urban areas as compared to rural things. Just a small input. This is a student survey done in between the years of 2014 to 2016. this was a very prominent news item which was prevalent at that given time in 2018, that every 1 hour one student is killing himself or herself. So that number accounts to be a very high morbidity on our young population. It has resulted into that around the duration of 2014 and 2016 years, around 26,476 students have killed themselves or died by suicide. According to World Health Organization survey in 2018, 1.5 lakh road deaths in India, that is total number of road traffic accidents, is 821 per day. That is 34 deaths per hour in India. And most of the age group people are youngsters. That is between the 5 to 39 age group. So these numbers don't look good and don't give us a very good comfortable input of how we are doing mental health wise and what are our issues prevailing all over. But it is also important that we take into consideration that how these things are affecting our stress level. If I have to look into what goes on around us, we have to look into the deeper aspects of how things are. Now, if I have to say that what is the situation of our life, this picture kind of gives me a very big insight. This is a random picture for most of you. One day I was just on a walk somewhere a bit deeper in the forest area, and I came across this hazy looking kind of picture, and I just thought of clicking it, because this is what our brain gets into, our thoughts, our feeling gets into when we are stressed. As you can see, there's a lot of haze. We can't see clearly, but actually it was a very dense spider web, and which made the look of the stones, leaves very hazy. And I just used it as a metaphor. So my main concern in talking to you today is, how do we look into stress management issues? Now, if I have to put it in a way that Dr. Seema has already given you my introduction, but what else do I do? So my prime area is neuropsychology. I do neuropsychological and psychological assessment. Many of us think that psychologists just counsel and talk about things to make us feel good. But some of us work more than that. So like in my hospital setup, we do assessment of different kinds, whether it is intellectual ability or somebody has had a head injury in a road traffic accident. So I look into what are the residual capacities left in the individual. And this is across the age group, across the disease condition. For example, a brain tumors patient's testing is required to know the lobe functions. For an Alzheimer or a dementia, Parkinson, neurocognitive evaluation has to be done, that how much he can think, how much he can plan, he or she, how much they can perceive the stimulants in their environment, what is the memory level functioning. Interestingly, not many of us know, but we do organ transplant psychological evaluation. So as medical systems have advanced over so many years, lifespan has changed, quality of life has changed. And in our organization, we do different organs transplant, right from heart, lungs, liver, kidney, cornea, sometimes in severe burn or injury cases, skin transplants. So we have to evaluate these patients psychologically. Are they ready for it? If they have a live donor, are they okay with the process of the big surgery? We also do certification for different intellectual disability. So the idea of sharing this information is, if we are working in so many fields related to the human life and health, you can imagine what kind of stress these people as patients or general people who are caregivers or family are undergoing. And this is just a small spectrum of the people that patients or family we are seeing. We have different levels of children and student issues, which are related to obviously the neurocognitive development. Some children we know have learning difficulties, dyslexias of different kind. Some kids have ADHD, attention deficit, hyperactivity disorder, or other neurodevelopmental disorders. And most of all, in today's time, because of the pandemic scenario, a lot of lifestyles, a lot of thinking ability of people have changed. So it is important to look at stress and deal with it in the change world scenario. Some of us do have existing life events which make things uncomfortable for us. So here I would like to mention, have a look at this left side of the slide and see, does any of these feelings or words resonate in your memory system? And my simple question is, do any of you or all of you feel, experience few or any of these symptoms? If yes, welcome to the world of being so-called normally knackered emotionally and physically. Somebody asked Dalai Lama, His Holiness Dalai Lama, what amused him most about humanity? And the answer, as you see on your screen, is that many of us sacrifice our lives doing things which are a part of the deal, but we take it to a level where those particular events, things, feelings, they become a hindrance in our growth of our life. So many of us feel that we will live forever and we can postpone, procrastinate, or keep our grudges, ill feelings, or arguments, conflict on and on. But that's not what life is about. Life is about learning, letting go, and moving forward. And those are the key things to help us to manage our stress. Now, a few of the most stressful events in one chart. This pandemic has been a major upheaval for almost everyone across the globe. Some people have lost family members. Some family members have become very sick suddenly. Some people have lost economic well-being, livelihood. There has been a lot of upheaval in the regular system, like you all being faculty or senior student, postdoctoral or research students. In the last 2 years, we have been working in a very different environment. So it can be any of these events or more than that also. Exams, relationship failures, rejections, instant gratification behavior, all that can be stressors in these given times. Some of us are able to vocalize and express it. Some of us live with it without really knowing how can those problems be solved or how those systems can be regenerated to have a better outlook. There is not a single person who can say he or she doesn't have one or the other of these issues. Sometimes, as I said, it can be anything for anybody. It can be stress related to work. Now, if I have to speak that, what are the determinants of mental health? So a simple and very easy statement would be multiple social, psychological, and biological factors determine the level of mental health of a person at any point of time. For example, persistent socioeconomic pressures are recognized as risk to mental health for individuals and communities itself. I'll give a very relevant example. For the last 2 weeks, we have been seeing some of the images and getting news about the scenario in Afghanistan. So many local people have been upheaved from the very basic roots, and they are being taken in some countries as refugees or being given asylum. But think of it in a deep way that these people have to start a life in a new environment, in a new socio-cultural setup, in a new geographical locality without really knowing what is there for tomorrow. Some of them will depend on charities. Some of them will be resorting for menial jobs to keep their day-to-day economic running. Okay. Yesterday, there was a small news item that a small baby was given a passport at an Indian Air Force base while being allowed in India because the baby was born during all this turmoil. Now think of it in a big, more macro style, macro way that what will this child really know in a new environment about his ancestry or his cultural heritage? And sometimes our roots, our value system, our environment is a kind of a stress stabilizer because it helps to find ways, means, and resonate with the system of the learning. Poor mental health is also associated with rapid social change, which we have been seeing in the last 15 years. Stressful work conditions, which all of you or some of you have seen in the last 1.5 to, and we will see it for the next year or so also. Gender discrimination, social exclusion, unhealthy lifestyle. Many of us in today's time do indulge in a lot of screen time, which is not just related to work, but we take it as an excuse that I am so exhausted from work, so I need to spend time watching some OTT content or playing mobile games, video game. I'm not against the point of enjoying things, but we do not discriminate that the brain also needs some rest and some kind of respite from the continuous activity of being overloaded with info. When there is risk of violence, the mental stress, the harmony, the way to survive becomes compromised. And long-term violence is a sure lead way to having or getting mental illness. We have enough history that people who were subjected to the concentration camp and the Nazi regime, they developed major mental health issues. People who have been kidnapped or undergone any kind of physical violence, they do have a higher incidence of mental illness issues. When there is simple human rights violation, the ability to trust, the ability to rely diminishes, which leads into major mental health issues over the period of time. In today's scenario, with the rapid changes in globalization, corporate structures, world resources, and the economy, people are under stress, whether as individuals, employers, employees, consumer, or a customer. In this situation, it is important to give emphasis to individualized stress management principles regarding personal needs for choices, materialistic dependency, addictions, and the external environmental interactions are a major factors leading us to get into stressful or being in a highly charged mode. And this is across the globe, across the civilization. If you look at into it in terms of the stress, we see that many people do report physical illness, which is actually a manifestation of a underlying chronic stress, which the body has been enduring for a long time. As you can see on the screen, overstimulation of the nervous system. When people say that somebody got heart attack suddenly, for doctors, the sudden part is not really a sudden part. It is a manifestation of an underlying disease for very many years. As such, our body, our physiological structures have been under process of change from millions of years. And at today's stage, we do not really care or respect, most of us. Think of it amongst yourself. How many are actively engaged in regular physical exercise, regular mental relaxation processes, or having a very optimal kind of healthy lifestyle? Many of us fail there. It's not in terms of that we cannot enjoy in terms of eating different foods, but that moderation sometimes we overcross. In my clinical setup, I always invariably every month see insomnia, a difficulty to fall asleep is a major cause of stress in people. Anxiety, depression are an everyday presentation, and this scores around every level of population spectrum. I have seen children who are just 5 and 7 year old, and the mother came with a complaint that first thing they get up in the morning is they want their iPad or phone to look at. Now, if one has to ask, how would a 5 or a 7 year old get dependent on these kind of gadgets or behavior? Obviously, somewhere the feedback has been from the adults to those children, and now they have become so dependent on it. And as we progress through the presentation, I will be sharing information that how our brain develops these kind of addiction very early on. So psychologically, as you can see on the right side of the screen, all these kind of changes, loss of interest in general day-to-day routine, feeling excessively dejected with the small achievements, always having a vision or a concern of not doing enough, is surely an indicator of major stress ongoing for quite some time in the person's life. As I mentioned earlier, these are some of the common symptoms with a lot of people report. Being overreactive, we commonly see in many of the cities, especially the urban metros, road rage, that if there is a scenario when somebody's crossing over to the wrong side, somebody will get very annoyed and literally start a fight on the road itself. And that fight can be sometimes very bad or very traumatic. Headaches are a common thing. We see in terms of the hospital environment, people say that they had been having headache for 4 or 5 years. And what the usual way is, okay, take some analgesic tablet, take some painkiller. There have been cases that due to over use of painkillers, people have had kidney injuries, which has gone to that extent that they have damaged their kidneys. And the only way to keep them going was a kidney, renal transplant. So it is important to address the underlying stress rather than just treating it on surface value and putting it like it's like just dusting the dust away from one corner of the house and piling it under the carpet. Now, a bit of medical scenario in terms of the stress level. As you can see, different disorders, they are surely impacting the health in due course of time. Nowadays, I commonly see eating disorders in terms of, some of you may have heard the name anorexia nervosa, where individuals have a feeling that they are fat and their body image is not good enough. And so gradually, over a period of time, they stop eating, and sometimes the malnutrition is so bad that other diseases or severe infections creep into the body. It's usually predominantly found in young teenage girls, but the underlying, one of the reasons, I'm not saying that the only reason, is that these girls have not been given due respect and approval in their growing age. So the other day I had a youngster who is actually currently now the first year MBBS student. So her age is around 19 plus. Her body weight currently is 38 kg. So you can imagine. And her input was that right from class seventh, when I was a bit chubby and healthy, everybody used to body shame me, saying, "You are so fat, you don't look good, you need to do something about." And so over these few years, from 12, 13 years till 19 years, the impact has been so deep, psychologically rooted, that now her body just doesn't accept food. Anything she eats, she happens to vomit it out. Hives, acne, some of these, all of us have gone through it. When we are too anxious, our stomach, the gut lining starts to rebel. Either some people have constipation or some people have diarrhea. Go back to your high school days. First time when you gave your first exam, I think so, most of us have had those butterflies in the stomach. I surely remember my first paper, I was like, oh, I don't know what I'm going to do. And I could feel my food churning in the tummy. So that kind of stress initially is important for us to move forward, but it shouldn't become a chronic every day or every week affair. Then it results into these kind of different illness, which I mentioned on the screen. This is a longitudinal study, which I'm going to talk about. In Johns Hopkins Hospital, since 2010, they have been doing a stress evaluation on the gene structure and genome changes. So they have found till date that long-term exposure to stress hormone affects genes linked to depression and bipolar disorder. This also results into long-lasting epigenetic changes. Epigenetic changes means that over a period of time, the basic genome is rewriting the code. So if you can see that from 2010 till 2021, it's already showing the indication. Think of it that through generations, when we are carrying unmanageable or uncontrolled stress, it is surely going to impact our long-term survival. Now, I would like to talk something about phases of hope, that when there is uncertain times, like what we have been seeing since last March, initially we are hopeful. It sounds funny, but many of us, me not as a clinician, but people had the concept that this COVID-19, SARS-CoV-19 would go away in India when the summer is peaking up, that the heat in Indian subcontinent is too strong for the virus to survive. So that was a lot of hope for many people. A lot of people did practice, and till today we see in our hospital setup, they have their own version of social distancing or masking up or sanitization. I'm sure a few of you have seen those videos that steam inhalation was overdone. A lot of people said, have lots of kadha and the virus is not going to attack you. I'm not against taking preventive measure, but overdoing anything to the body is putting the body into a stress. So as you see in this slide, we, all of us in different situation, whether it's a change, whether it's a life event, stressful, we go through these kind of thinking, that we are hopeful, then we are not sure what is happening, then we feel kuch nahi ho sakta hai, and then slowly we start looking at things in a different perspective, and then we find ki, okay, there are some survival modes which we can adopt over a period of time. It is very important to understand that if we are not aware of ourselves, we will not know how to deal, how to manage, or how to overcome the changes of the system. Using the example of the pandemic, all of us or few of us have been very worried to an extent. Initially, the issues were fear of the unknown. We didn't know what the virus was going to do. Over these periods of few months, almost 1.5 years plus, at least some of the virologists and clinicians, doctors in good setup have a protocol of medication in case the infection creeps into a patient and depending on what kind of level the disease is playing. So, but at the initial part, when we were in the lockdown phase, there was a lot of media info overload, uncertainty. When the lockdown will be opening, when will I go back to my job, when will I meet my friends, when can the colleges restart. Students of different age were obviously very apprehensive because it was a challenge for everybody across. There was a lot of decreased live interaction, work design change, work from home, which otherwise we had been dreaming and envisioning all the time. It became a reality. And after a few months, it became a very boring phenomena for most of us. How could one just sit in one room and not really see people, not exchange ideas in person? There were a lot of job losses. I'm not saying it is not still there. Still, people have had major losses in their businesses or in their ventures. So these financial setbacks became a major stressors. For the pandemic, in the initial stage, the word I used was fast-moving pandemic, and it is resulting into a slow-moving disaster. As academicians, many of you, obviously you're teaching at higher education level, so the impact to the students is in at a different level. But many of us have families and we see children. The small children age group, say 5+ till 17, 19, they thrive on social interaction. They develop their personality and social skills by meeting other kids, going to a school. All their learning has been certainly curtailed and compromised. So as a mental health professional, I and my colleagues worry that the next 2-3 years, whenever the schools are going to be normally opened, we will have a very different response system by these children who are going to go back to school in a normal phase, because they have lost a lot of time in learning the basic skills of communication, personal time management, personal self-regulation. Many of the education boards across the country have given kind of a walkover for class 10th and 12th exams, which are in a way, obviously in our Indian education system, a big stressor, but they are also a preparation for a youngster to understand and assimilate information through the subject while writing in a stipulated time through exams. But these kids have not been exposed to that kind of environment. So there is going to be a mindset that life will be easy for them at every given time, which is itself a big illusion and is going to affect their way of problem solving and handling situation in the due course of time. Now, when we talk about feelings, emotion, some of us are good at expressing, but some of us are very naive, or we have not learned behaviors which can be effective in communication. All these points which I've made on this slide indicate towards that if we have a actual overall understanding around these features, our way of communicating, adjusting, and managing the stress becomes much more easier. I would like to share this slide that in terms of physiological response, this is a very famous clinician, researcher, and he got the Nobel Prize long back away, long, long back ago, and I find this sentence true to the core of what he has said. All of us understand acidic and alkaline environment. We have started about these right from class 7th basic science. But how many of us do try to keep our environment alkaline, whether it is our body's environment or whether it is our external work environment? It is important that we use education and our life experience to make things change according to the optimum way of survival. Here I would like to emphasize, we cannot change anybody else outside. But having an understanding that my body is under stress, my brain, my mind, my thoughts are going a bit uncomfortably unwell is important. All of us know about the basic structure of our central nervous system, the autonomic, parasympathetic, sympathetic nervous system. I'm not going to go into the biology and anatomy of all that, but just using, because the basics all of us do remember from our biology lessons. When we are able to regulate our breathing, when we are able to listen to our heart pounding very hard and recognize that this threshold or this tipping point is affecting my pulse rate, my respiration rate, because I'm overthinking, overanalyzing, over speculative. We need to change it for better homeostatic state. Because as I said, long-term stress, you have seen in the previous slides, does affect our body environment, resulting into major chaos in due course of time. Think of it normally. By the time our parents, our elders are into 60, 70 or late 40s, the doctor visits and hospital bills and medication bills start to rise. Do we really look into that? What can be done at an early stage that we don't end up spending half of our earnings in the hospital? I'm not saying that hospital visits are not required. Some emergencies will happen. That's part of the deal. But overall, India is seeing a very, very big surge in lifestyle-related disease. Some people, whether they have whichever background of education, they tell me, diabetes is a genetic problem in my family. But most of us know it is not a genetic disease per se, but it is the inherited cultural and social system in the family which do not allow a person to eat healthy, exercise, or relax in a particular way. I'll give a very simple example. People who have partners who are not into gymming or exercise or walking will attract people who do the same negative behavior. Another example is, if I as an adult is sitting and watching phone screen or any OTT content or laptop till 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock in the night, how can I tell a youngster in the family that you are supposed to sleep? We have to understand that we have to be role models. It may surprise you, but this is again a clinical medical fact that, it doesn't apply for all the children, but at 12 years age, our heart arteries start to harden. This may come as a surprise, but it's again a well-established, researched understanding which clinicians have derived over a long period of seeing what are the genesis and why do some people get heart attack even in their early 30s or late 20s. The reason is that right from the beginning, we do not motivate, we do not indulge. I use the sentence that your health or my health is my responsibility, not the governments, not the hospitals, not the doctors. And some awareness we need to find in terms of a balanced view that how do we do things that people become more healthy, they are more conscious about their choices, and they have an insight that life is not about just running and chasing. It is about enjoying and taking it things at a slower pace sometimes. Now, some very important and simple examples. We all know about it, but we don't practice and apply. As simple as that, that there will be some times that even my stress level or anxiety will go out of proportion. Even if I'm a mental health professional, it shouldn't mean that I have to shy away and think, oh, if I go and tell my problems or my discord about my family to some other mental health professional or a colleague or friend, what will they think about him? Beyond being a clinician, beyond being a woman, I am still a human being, and it's okay to seek help. So we need to acknowledge that having small bouts of depression or anxiety or feeling overworried about certain things, it's a natural response. And sometimes when things or situations or our thoughts are unmanageable, it is important that we seek support, seek help, or get in connected to a level where we can find better solutions. It may not work for us, but sometimes looking at things from a different aspect is also important. All of us know that our culture, our country has given yoga, pranayam to the whole of the world. It was very interesting to know, and I will use my phone to read out that caption about what it is in terms of how marketing happens and how things are depicted at a level where it becomes very sellable and different in terms of what is pranayam, what is breathing exercise, and what it is. So it says, cardiac coherence breathing exercise can stabilize the heartbeat and have a powerful ability to dampen anxiety. And this has come out in a Scientific American journal. And some other person has commented, so pranayam becomes cardiac coherent breathing and it works. Meditation becomes mindfulness and it changes life. Yoga becomes stretching and relaxation workout and is useful. Upvas becomes intermittent fasting and it keeps weight in control. But Ayurveda yoga becomes superstitions. The idea of reading out this was we have the basic know-hows of living better, creating better harmony and being more productive and useful. But the point is, at times we do not apply it. We ignore it in terms of ki some other day, it is not meant for me. The important message is, it is a matter of here and now, not tomorrow and then. So look into these aspects and start gradually implementing. I'm not saying all of it needs to be implemented, what one or the other thing. It will improve the quality of life. Some of the small things, which again, we know about it, but we don't practice or we keep it for the next then and there, which compromises our quality of life today. Most of us know about these things, so I'm not going to elaborate. Somatic and art therapy approaches as possible bridge to symbolize and verbalize the unspeakable. These methods are known to be major stress busters and known to be accommodative to an ability of a better survival. Now, this is something I wanted to talk when I was talking about neurochemicals. Again, some of these names are very well known to all of us. I would specifically focus on dopamine. I'm not going to read the slide. All of you can see it for yourself. When we are over-engaged with screen time, it is a kind of a reward center. And if you look into the deeper networks of these chemical pathways in our brain, dopamine has a major capital area covered. So anything which gives us reward, dopamine is fired through the neural network. And dopamine is an elating neurotransmitter, the good feel factor. So if I have a nice chocolate cake, it makes me feel happy, high, and I feel like going and eating a bit more. It can be a chocolate cake, it can be a bowl of kheer, it can be some nice cheesy pizza, or even fried food or chips. Think of it, most of us, if we open a packet of chips, we don't stop till it finishes. It is also addictive and highly dependent because it gives us that high. So when we are watching content continuously, going back to that case example of a 5 and 7 year old child, when they used to play these games and all, the streak of winning or doing a certain task, getting a high score, makes us feel very elated and very self-sufficient. But in the long term, it also takes away a lot of energy because dopamine surge requires a constant go. What we say, ki on the run mill all the time. If we do not stop and change over other activities, we feel defeated, we feel dejected, and we feel incomplete. So I'll give an example. People who are anxious, they can't wait in a queue. Some people eat the food very hurriedly. Some people don't allow others to speak because they are on the go moment and they are in the rat race scenario. If I don't do this, something else will not be done. And that results into a complete dopamine surge in the brain chemicals. When it is deprived, when those activities are not done, the person, the organism feels uncomfortable, incompetent, not useful. And it results into a cumulative behavior of feeling low, irritable, anxious, or even sometimes highly angry. In certain mental illness, we look into that what brain chemicals are depleted or what are over circulating in the neural network. And based on that, the psychiatrist gives medication. But these activities, which I mentioned on the slide, they don't need any major chemical input. As you said, see, oxytocin, a very basic example. When a first-time mother or a second-time mother holds a newborn baby to breastfeed, automatically in the baby's brain and the mother's brain, oxytocin is secreted. When we find somebody of our liking or somebody of our choice as a friend, as a partner, as a spouse, oxytocin is secreted because that bonding, that emotions help the neural network to surge and make the bond strong. There have been studies which have seen that in some of these psychopaths which have caused criminal scenarios in the system, in society and things, when scientists, clinicians studied their brain, oxytocin secretions were very low. And when we traced and looked into the history or the social, cultural system, many of these small individuals as kids were either bullied or faced trauma through physical violence by parents or caregivers. So in today's time, we can see these actual scientific effect in person's behavior, even through a basic psychological interview. When I was talking about how to deal with stress, look at these prominent questions. sometimes as adults, it is important to sit back and introspect. Sadly, in today's time, very, very few people do that. Because as I use the term that we are in the race for going on a road where we don't know the road goes into, we don't know how we are going to make it, but we are driven by a system somewhat inherited, somewhat learned, and somewhat envisioned that we have to just keep going. When I've said inherited, it goes back to a history of the colonialism. We were slaves for almost two centuries, and that also had an impact on our ancestors' mindset of that if you don't do well, you're not going to survive. And that wellness translated into a post-independence era also, since the 60s and 70s has been that you have to become somebody to be something known in this world. I'm not saying that we don't need acknowledgement or we don't need to be somebody, but we don't have to be somebody by looking at life from other people's lenses. I use this very common example in my OP clinic every day that I cannot look at the screen with somebody else's glasses, spectacles. Maybe for 1 or 2 minutes doing the adjustment, I can have a look at the screen. But after some time, I will have a headache. My eyes will strain. And that's where I use the sentence, asking some questions for ourselves. As adults, I do advise that literally every 6 months, we need to evaluate what it is we are doing good. It's not that all the time we are doing bad. Sometimes we are doing good. And we need to pat ourselves. We need to have that compassion and acknowledgement for ourselves. But if things are not really going well all over around us, we need to really step back and look at it as a third person's perspective. Many of us go through this. Oh, if only I could get that car. If only I could get that next promotion. If only I could go to XYZ country for a celebration, or if only I could get that particular flat. It's not just economics, but other pragmatic social systems also that we keep on craving. But many of us do not really enjoy what we have. Most of us thankfully have good health, which is a blessing. Most of us thankfully have family systems or social system where somebody or other is supporting us. So instead of if and but, if it is yes and now, stress goes down. It sounds very small, but try it for a week. When I say using psychological instrument, introspection, journaling, talking to a qualified professional, mental health professional. It is not that people are mentally ill or inefficient that they need to talk to a psychologist or a psychiatrist. Many of the, I'll use my work experience. I have worked overseas in a couple of different systems, organization. So I'm using an example from South Africa. People used to take 6 o'clock, 6 a.m. appointment to see psychologists because through the day they were working hard, and it was not that they were ill or inefficient or they had major psychological issues, but just to have a perspective on different aspects of life. There are therapy systems where families go together to exchange their hidden ill feelings about each other. There's not a single family on this earth which will not have a discord. But some of the times we are just using that situation as a passive aggression. I may disagree with some other members of my family, but instead of expressing or vocalizing it either through a shouting match or banging things, I'll keep it hidden. And which will result into my stress levels be of anger, discomfort, or feeling unhappy will show up sometime. If not, emotionally, it will reflect in my body somewhere or the other through some illness. Now, the takeaways. All of us know we only have this one life. So find your passion other than your job and boyfriend, girlfriend, or your partner. All of us have some passion, but we forget or ignore it. But those passions, those likings, or those hobbies are the food for your inner well-being. Please start enjoying things. Many of the adult patients say, "Pehle hum karte the. Pehle main cricket khelta tha. Pehle main dance karti thi. Pehle main doodling ya drawing, sketching karti thi. Ab kuch nahi karti hun." And I ask, who has told you to stop? Ki time nahi milta hai. And then I say the same example. 24 hours for the bird, 24 hours for the worm, 24 hours for the lion, and 24 hours for the human being. And if we have developed brain of such big cognition systems that we are able to reach the moon and Mars, why can't we do something for ourselves? So look at that life from a different aspect where things are more easy and more comfortable for you. And as I said in the beginning of the presentation, outside environment we cannot control at all. So instead of seeing that X is the problem or Y is the creator of the problem, have your understanding about how can things be done differently. What do I respond to a shouting boss or senior to make things easy for myself, not for him or her, but for yourself? It is very important to build patience and balance in today's time specifically. As I said earlier, that we have been living in a world of instant gratification. Abhi kar lo, kal to kuch hoga nahi. And there I use the example. It is important to understand that whatever you can do, you have to discriminate. Is it a need or a want? Many of us have stopped looking into it. Everything is a want. I want this, I want. But do we really think, do I need it? And that need and want difference is a major bridge between increasing your stress or living without the stress. How many birds collect food for the next day and 10 days and 10 years? We as human life beings in today's time do collect, but how much can we eat more than the basic requirement of the body? And then why do we need to worry ki we will not have tomorrow? If our basic skills, if our basic understanding, if our basic health is good, most likely we will make it. Think of it again in this pandemic scenario. Many of us have lost people, but the major chunk has still survived. And if we don't learn from these changing scenarios, which the bigger power is showing to us, then there will be no learning anyway. It's very bad to keep grudges and grievances all around us, because it's like handling coal, burning coal in your palm and trying to walk on ice sheets. Because when we are angry, when we are upset, when we are having grudges or grievances, it depletes the energy. And we are always being a table tennis match in our brain, the ping pong ball. If and but, if I would have said this, then he would have done that. If I would have not done this, then that would have not happened. Or he did this and that. Go back to your memory system. How many of you keep on having this conversation half the time in your brain? Just for a small input, in a day we have more than 60 to 80,000 thoughts in a day, but productive and valuable thoughts are not even 20. 25 for some people. So think of it, that if you want to keep your brain easy, let go of the grudges. Earn how to receive. Anything is not going to come to you free. There is never a free lunch. Whether we eat, again, a 7-course meal or we eat simple rice, dal. And that I'm using as a very primitive example. If something comes very free and easy for you, be sure it is not going to be there long. The hardest of all, judge less, or if you can, don't. Again, a part of our survival is that we judge things and then we walk forward. But now it is a very primitive concept in our brain, because go back to the animal life. If a deer who is grazing nicely on a grassland does not judge about the hustling in the nearby bushes, or does not sense that a big cat as a lion tiger is nearby, he or she, the deer animal, is going to get killed. But what we have started doing is that we have started judging people based on their basic outer presentation, which make things very complex for our own survival. As I use the example that we look at life from other people's lenses. Using this very important quote, I find it important. He who is not contented with what he has would not be contented with what he would like to have. Because then it just gives the brain the thought process that something more needs to be done. It doesn't mean that we don't work towards our progress and well-being, but it also means that we have the reflection that, is this what we want or is this what we need? These are some of the very good recommendations. If anybody is interested, you can take a screenshot and look at these books or blogs over a period of time. They surely give a very deep insight into finding yourself, understanding things and problems from a bigger perspective. These are the references which I have used over a period of time to understand better things. And they give us simple WHO website, World Health Organization, has a section on mental health. And they have very small videos and animated files which help us to deal with anxiety, depression, small problems which we have. Even it deals with substance abuse and all. So sometimes when I see people don't want to share or don't want to acknowledge, I always say to my clients and their family that if you have correct resources around you, in the case of need be, you or somebody can direct you to better survival mode. Thank you so much. I am open to any comments. I'll stop sharing the screen and I would like to hear from you or anybody. Dr. Seema can give the input.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Thank you very much for such a nice talk and quite, it was such a nice deliberation.
Thank you.
Issues. You talked about so many simple things which we really ignore, like for granted, okay, fine, walk pe jana hai, aaj nahi, okay, let's see, we'll go to. Very much taking it as a must to do on a daily basis. So for me, I always say, I work sometimes. So it's better that we promise ourselves that do it for today and then tomorrow we'll see. Then again, helps much in a long way. It really helps.
Exactly.
And now the session is open for interaction, queries, questions. We will be glad if you share your experiences on this platform. You can raise your hand so I can unmute you. Anyone with your issues at workplace, issues with your mental health, daily life.
And I would even say, if it is not about issues, I'm sure there are a lot of participants who have better coping mechanism. It would be good that we all learn from each other that if somebody is feeling stressed, what do they do to disengage from their stress level? All of us sometimes or other have better plans. And that's why, as I said, we have survived as a race. Everybody didn't learn to run at top speed. Some of us just learn to walk a bit, but then others' motivation help us to do better things in due course of time.
Yeah, there is one question. Yeah, there is one query from Shekhar. He's saying, what can I do to stop procrastinating things?
Wonderful. All of us do that. As you said, ki kal walk pe jayenge.
Kal jayenge.
Procrastination counts because, again, that feeling of effort. Any change is a bit challenge. Any change and any effort is a change which leads to us thinking that baad mein dekh lenge, baad mein kar lenge. But a very simple technique is that, suppose, I'll use the simple example of walk. Ki tomorrow, if I'm planning for a walk, why don't I walk in the house exclusively just 10 minutes today? So we get the momentum going. And that helps the body to feel good. Okay, I didn't go for 20 minutes, but at least I put a music song and I danced and I stretched. So that itself is the first step. Nobody can climb Himalaya, mountains, Everest in one go. We have to prepare the body. As Indians, we, irrespective of the gender, we have seen the cricket team right from the beginning. All of us know, I'm not talking about this pandemic scenario, but when the players go overseas, they go a few days before to acclimatize the climate so the body can endure that stress. Same thing, doing a small bit of the task is the first step to go. And what we say in other language, baby steps. When you were born and when you started standing, you didn't run the first day. All of us fell. All of us were trembling here, there. Some either adult family member was holding and walking. So find people who are doing those kind of activities and they will help you support. So I even say to, if somebody is addicted to smoking, if you have to leave that smoking habit, many of us said, acha, that even that day I will stop smoking. But find some people who have stopped smoking, talk to them, know them. So the first is breaking the task into the small event. So it becomes the first step. Second thing is doing it at a given particular time. Is put a time block on your phone. All of us have these phones these days. Put a time block. 15 minutes, I have to review these references to write my next research paper. 15 minutes, I have to... Theek hai, I'm not actively exercising, but I will look at motivating videos or some YouTube channel which talks about self. But then if it is 15 minutes, keep it 15 minutes only. Third thing is, when I said, keep find like-minded people, they become a big motivator. So these are two, three important steps which helps us to get to the task rather than procrastinating it. Sometimes we procrastinate because of the fear, because we are not trained or we are not skilled to deal with it. Then we do seek, if it is a continuous habit, we do seek psychological support.
One question is, that how to live in the present moment.
Okay, I'm being a bit partial. I'm using Hindi language song, and I love that song. My personal preference. I'm one of the good actors, Shah Rukh Khan, Kal Ho Na Ho. There's never a tomorrow. Same example. Can you really earn for 10 generations? Do we need it? I'm being a bit biased for my own gender. Females, they will keep their jewelry and sari tab pehnenge, tab mauka aayega. It's a very common thing in women. Again, there is a primitive reason for that, because women have been designed through these millions of years to be preservers. So that habit also creeps into us, feeling ki there will be some other occasion. Enjoy today. But the cutting question here is, what is the moderation? Who decides that 2 bottles of beer are enough for me, or somebody else decides? So any kind of indulgence, overindulgence, doesn't let us to be in present scenario. And that's also our thoughts. If you're not in the present, then you're not giving your full attention, concentration, and your productive value. So when these thoughts start to run, first of all, it happens in our brain. So understand, thoughts, feelings, habits, this is the way. And habits become our actions. Thoughts and feelings, we need to have it in a very focused way. If I am in a lecture, my phone doesn't ring, the doorbell, if it is ringing, it doesn't matter. But when the thought is that, acha, lunch mein I have to make dal chawal, or today evening guests are coming, or today I have to watch that movie, I'm not doing the job here. Sometimes we need to literally snap ourselves. One screen at a time. Many of us have been strongly advocating that please make it a point that you do not carry your phone to your bedside table or your dining table. And people said, but my meeting call is going to come. My boss may email me anytime. I have to be alert. Then are you really enjoying your food? When we are sitting in front of the screen and eating our food, do we really know what the flavor of the sabji or the raita is? What's the difference between, I'm not being discriminatory or disrespectful to the animals, what's the difference between us and the animals? So think of it, being in present is here and now, because that is the only moment you have in a given day. You only have some 80 plus thousand seconds, and that's your money. That's your life for the day. I do not know in the next 3 hours I'm going to be alive or not. But this 1.5 hour, if I have to be with you people, that's my life. And that's what matters. Nothing beyond that, nothing true. We need to plan. I'm not saying we cannot plan. But in today's time, having a 10-year plan is like literally trying to walk on the Jupiter without a space suit.
One question is from one of the participants saying, ma'am, what should we do to protect ourselves if somebody is mentally harsh on us, or a harsh harsh behavior and mental trauma they are producing?
See, if it is an ongoing process or behavior by that particular individual. So, for example, I use it in a very small example, which I see. Many times, a lot of people are very aggressive. Mental harshness can be a part of that. They say simply like angry all the time for a small thing, big thing, shouting, being very rude, or being very sarcastic, critical. So if you see that personality of that individual is like that, we need to really, and if it's a family member, we really need to consult a mental health professional, because being too aggressive is also an underlying factor for mental illness. It can be a bipolar disorder, it can be a personality disorder, it can be a mood disorder, any of that. But if the person is on and off, then maybe there is some stressor which is working on that individual's life or thought process. Some people who are very insecure in themselves, I'm not saying everybody, you know, they are also aggressive to hide their low efficiency. I'll give a very, very primitive example. There are a lot of stray dogs in India, all across cities and villages and towns. Whenever a new dog is approaching a lane, the other dogs will start barking aggressively. And that is because territorial invasion is happening. But if this dog is lean and weak, it will either run away or submit to them. If there are too many of them, they will bark, maul, or do whatever. But the idea is that that barking, the shouting is an indication that they are feeling the threat. And that's why they are imposing. And that's why I say many of us do behave very primitively when we are angry or emotionally upset. So the idea is, if it is a constant way and people are in a colleague environment, if it is a boss and always shouting and being rude and sarcastic, sometimes we have to submit to it, but you shouldn't let your mental peace and health go over the fall for it. Sometimes you will have to take a stand, but that doesn't mean that we shout back. In our work efficiency, in our environment, we need to be strong enough to put facts and figures rather than name calling and retaliating in the same way. But if it is a family member and there are mood swings and there are, as I said, continuous on and off, if they are open to listening and taking support good enough from the family members, maybe look into the deeper reasons. And if you think that something is surely missing, it is a good idea to take a medical consult for them. For yourself, if you have today, keeping to your routine and thinking from a third person's perspective. It is never my way or highway. It is always the midline. If somebody is threatening your personal integrity, I would strongly say take a stand. But obviously, suppose if I'm in Afghanistan and I take a stand, the bullet will go through my head within a second. And that discrimination has to be, that comes from being observing, seeing the hidden language or the incoherent communication. There are two types of cooperation. Communication. One is coherent. What I say, I speak, and I portray it through my words, work output, or through my adherence to that. I have to submit the project, or I have to give this talk. I acknowledge to Dr. Seema and say, okay, this is the way. If I'm like, yeah, maybe I'll do it, but I'm not sure, and this, that, I'm accepting, but I'm unaccepting. So that communication difference also decides that how you can assimilate and give the info to the person.
One question is from Sonu Kumar. He's saying that how will I be able to create an alkaline environment around myself?
Threefold. First, is it at physical level? Second is that emotional level. And third is at the environmental level. And that comes with self-regulation. As I said in the beginning, make sure your physical needs of the body are met. There may be always stressors. Life is about different kind of stress. Again, giving an example, if I could have a live connect with you, I would ask this question. Tell me, what is the first time you had stress in your life? I'm assuming answers, which is a barrier because of this virtual platform scenario. But many people give answers as, when I had exam, when I had a heartbreak due to failed relationship, or when my teacher scolded me, or my parent rebuked me or something. That's not the first time when you had stress. The time when all of us came out of our mother's womb was the first time your body faced the stress. And as a clinician, it is one of the best markers for me. All of us know that when the baby is born, it has to cry because this lungs are expanding. It has to start working on its own. And that's the first time you faced stress in the physical world. So going back to your question, stresses will be around, but keeping a healthy sleep routine. Sleep is one of the best stress busters. But look at it. How many of us do stick to sleep timings? Sleep can wait. Season of the show has to be finished. Chatting has to be finished. Facebook, all notes, whatever they are called, have to be looked into. Everything else can be done now, but sleep can wait. Getting 7 to 8 hours of sleep on regular time. Please remember, on the regular time. Body is not based on ki today, this time, tomorrow, that time. Think of it, if the sun and moon did this, what will happen to the environment of this earth? Sun is just a solar star. If one day it decides to rise at 6 and then another day at 12 in the afternoon, what would happen to human life and animal life on this earth? So stick to routines, have good health food items, which I mentioned, a lot of greens, extra vitamin C when you are under stress, not as supplement, but through natural resources. Simple as, make it a point, if you do not have major acid issues or some other problem, have a glass of Nibu Pani for sure. It is one of the alkalinizers. It is acidic in it, but it helps the acid to get balance sorted out. Sleep, good fruit intake, because most of the fruits, they make the body system clean. They take away the toxins. All of us know, you people are science students better than me, or science faculty, that the body is under wear and tear morning to evening. Through the day we are born till the time we die. So those residuals, if they keep depositing, it becomes acidic. But if we are using natural antioxidants, lot of cherries, berries, amla, natural sources of vitamin C, one of the best way to alkaline your body. As for the mind, do not overload. Stay in here and now. You should have enough to survive, but not enough, ever enough, that you can be somebody else. And when I say environmentally, if you have a lot of negative people around, it is not that you fight with them or you disengage with them, but you don't need to really be with them mentally, emotionally connected to keep getting their emotional outburst on you. That would be my very basic takeaways for keeping your system going.
Okay, now Dr. Shireen Masroor has a question. Unmute yourself, Shireen.
Yes, ma'am, done. Hello.
Yes.
Good morning, ma'am. It is very nice to hear you and in the college. And it's all because of Seema ma'am and Arun sir. Actually, ma'am, as I have heard your lecture, so I have one query that you said that what we are doing nowadays, we are fully dependent on the gadgets and all these things. So, and our children are following us. They are just keeping their steps on our foot. So how can we get rid of these things? Means everything is now online, either in any stream. We have to work online. We have to be dependent on the mobiles, on the laptops. But the things, they are monitoring us for the whole day. And when we are keeping ourselves busy in the internet, so on that free time, they are also making the full use of internet. So how can we get rid of these things? I mean, how can we snatch those gadgets from them?
See, it's a very practical and important question that you brought it up. Thank you. It's a very common complaint which I hear very often. Same thing. Yes, if I'm on the system from 8 or 9 till 6 or 7, how can I stop the younger people? Mm-hmm. But in between, as I said, why do we need the phone or laptop on the dining table or where we sit and eat? Why do we need to have the TV on? We say, time nahi milega, so I want to watch my show now. Hmm. But is the show important, or being with the family or talking to your kid is important? Hmm. Same thing is, it's about also a bit about of a parenting or a family skill, that when we are doing work around our day-to-day running, whether you are a professor or you are a student or you are an admin person, whichever, we still have basic chores in the house.
Yes, definitely.
And it is not about, again, gender-specific roles. Today's time, everybody needs to be knowing the basics of survival all through the socio-economic class and strata. So a good thing is, make sure that when you are in the kitchen, even if your kids are 2 and 5 or 7 or 9 or 19, they are around and they are doing small things around. Because what is there? We run in between as adults to juggle around the other task or chores of the house. But the kid or the teenager just sits and goes on the screen. So make it a point that 15 minutes, literally, as I said, put a time block. We will play cards. We will play Ludo. We'll play a game of Antakshari, whatever it is. And this is the way that you start engaging them slowly, slowly. So it also comes into that everybody is given a chore in a given household. So whether it is dusting the lounge or putting up the dishes in the dried dishes section, or doing a grocery shopping online or in person, making the list. It is preparing the kids for their future involvement and engagement. And that helps them to also understand ki there is more responsibility in survival rather than just being on the screen. I always say ki it is important to keep right from the beginning these kind of regulation, so kids or younger people engage in the responsibility of learning different survival modes by knowing how to do things. Many of us go back to your childhood and all that. Sometimes our parents said, too small, no, when she is grown up, she'll learn how to cook. Or even for the guys, what is the importance of he doing his work, putting his clothes in the cupboard? I am there to do, the mother or the other sister or somebody would do. But it is not about he or she cannot do. It is about seeing the importance that we are self-reliant. Morning, make it a point that the kids of whichever age, I'm not saying a 2-year can pick up the mattress or fold the sheet, but as simple as making your bed in the morning, that's your responsibility. That's generating a chain of reaction where that I have to be vigilant to plan my things and do accordingly. And keep it as simple as that. You will have screen time, whether you want to chat to your friends or look at Facebook or social media, depending on the different age group. But after XYZ is done. So keep it as a reward system. And then they understand ki certain tasks have to be fulfilled before I get my comfort level of enjoying the game or watching the show or on that. I also strictly advise that there are guidelines. Look into the American pediatric guidelines that how much screen time is okay for a kid from 2 years till 19 years and what kind of content has to be used. I'm being a bit skeptical, but a lot of our kids are watching adult content at a very young age without understanding the emotional connect or reality about it. And then when they grow up as adults, they have interpersonal problems, which I'm seeing very commonly nowadays.
Okay. So Shireen, is it okay? Or you have to ask some more questions? Shireen, are you there? Amisha, I'm unmuting you. You can ask your question. You have put one question in the chat box. Yes. Yes, Amisha, ask a question.
Yes, ma'am. Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon.
Ma'am, according to me, our mental pace is very important. So, ma'am, I want to know, how can we gain our mental peace?
At a beginner level, because we have not been trained from a very early age, there are certain exercises which help the brain thoughts to not overindulge. One of them is introspection, or simple Hindi mein jise bolte hain dhyan karna, meditation. I'm not talking in terms of any spiritual or religious content, but literally sitting for 5 minutes, 2 minutes for yourself, and just watching your breathing process, up and down, and not thinking what is Dr. Seema doing, what is Dr. Nisha doing, what is XYZ doing, or what I have to do. Not here and there, but here and now. And this is the first step to start building. Nowadays, luckily, there are a lot of apps, which, as I read that caption, which is about mindfulness. So helping you to understand, to be comfortable in your own thing. And that's the first space. When I use that example, ki not living too much far in the future and not living too much behind in the past. I use this example because believe me, all of us get that thought. Kal kya hoga? Oh, tab usne mujhe aise bola tha. So that is not right. That is not good. Shut the future window and cut the past. I'm giving another example. Some of you must be driving on roads. Can we really look through our vision power and through our screen 60 meters or 100 or 150 meters ahead on the road? No, we can look at 20 meters, 40 meters, maybe 50 meters. Can we keep looking behind when I'm driving in the front? What will happen? I will collide with somebody in the thing. If I keep on looking on the sides, right and left, somebody will bang me from the other side. So using this example, that here and now, and discarding too much information. Everything on the internet, I do not need to know. A lot of people with anxiety tell me, to distract myself, I keep looking so I can gain knowledge. How much knowledge do you really know? And how much of that knowledge, it's actually not knowledge, it is just info. How much of info do we really need to do the next wonder about getting a Nobel Prize? We don't need it, but these are illusions which we create around us. So keep your systems very content. Have a timeline for small things. Prioritize your routines. A is priority. B is second level. C is can do or postpone it. But have a look at it every week. And then you will be doing, as I said, on the procrastination part. Some chunk of it will get done. Your mental peace, your sense of achievement, your sense of fulfillment will automatically come. And these are the basic ingredients which help the mental peace to regain. Surely indulge in some creative hobby. That really helps. It will be done some other day. If you like dancing, put the music and dance for 5 minutes.
But ma'am, we don't have that much time now.
When will the time come?
I don't know, ma'am.
It's important, Amisha, to delegate certain things. first to ourselves and then to others. We feel overwhelmed because we are trying to do everything in the same given time reference. And that is where I said priorities. Yes, college is a priority. Assignments or exams is a priority. But beyond that 7-8 hours, can you really keep on reading? Develop your templates around those things. A, B, C, and it will help.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Dr. Kavita Verma would like to ask a question. Kavita, you can unmute yourself. Kavita Verma, are you there, Kavita? You are the co-host. I have unmute yourself, please. There is one more person. The name is not written. It is ANC059. Ask your question, introduce yourself, and ask your question.
Good afternoon, ma'am. I'm Annapurna Kumari from the physics department. Ma'am, my question is, sometimes we know that what something is wrong with us, or we are stuck in something like in memory kind of thing, but still we couldn't make an effort to work on particular thing that I have to cut this thing. Like we feel sometimes really hopeless, but still we could not work on particular thing. Then how we have to deal with that kind of behavior of ourselves?
See, this is also very important. All days in a month cannot be the same kind of output. One needs to see that, is it a physical ailment, or it's an emotional issue, or it's some kind of, you know, thought which is bothering us, which makes us feel clutched or which feels us restricted. If it has been an ongoing feeling or discomfort for more than 3 weeks, then I would surely say it is okay to talk to a professional. It helps to really put the perspective from a different angle. Sometimes, I'll give an example. Sometimes actually we are thirsty, but we end up eating. Have you, any of you had that kind of experience?
Yeah. I agree.
Yeah, so because our thirst centers and hunger centers are literally overlying each other in a backside of the brain.
Okay.
And same way, these feelings or discomfort are a hidden part of it that we feel uncomfortable accepting the challenge or taking the change. Because as I said in the presentation, change is a challenge in itself. A lot of people who are alcoholic or drug abusers, they give the reason, because so and so troubled me, so I want to, that's why I drink. We have heard these kind of dialogues in movies or in real life also, na?
Yes, ma'am.
Because going to a level where I have to give up alcohol is a challenge of coming out and facing the reality or the harsh truth, or going to do something about my problem behavior. So if it is like a very core, deep-rooted anxiety or worry or, like mental block, I would say seek help. It applies to anybody. As I said, it can be not that everybody is mentally ill or sick or can't handle, that's why they need. But going to a good professional and seeking the support from a different perspective helps. Sometimes it can be that a lot of patients, when I see in the clinic, in the childhood, they have been too much controlled. So they have never developed their own navigation skills to walk firmly on the ground. And they feel uncertain or jittery around what they are doing, how they are doing. So when I'm feeling too jittery or shaky, I would rather not do it rather than get into that stress and trouble. And that's why we take that back step, and slowly, slowly it starts to suck us down. It is like a quicksand scenario in those kind of things. Anxiety, depression are very good friends. They walk hand in hand.
Yes, ma'am.
Keep that in mind and then look into the problem or situation. It will give you a better perspective.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
Welcome.
Any more question from anyone? Any question, you can raise your hand or you can just write in the chat box.